Okay, hello and welcome everyone. In this video, I'm going to talk about demand and supply, and I'm going to call attention to some aspects of the model that I think are often overlooked when people are first introduced to it. Also, yes, I am definitely 100% wearing a black shirt and then a shade of brown over it. And I think actually these colors go awesome together. I don't understand why everybody has such a problem with brown and black close together. So I know my mind is wired completely different from the rest of the world. But when I introspect, there could be like one reason for why I think this is the case. And that has to do with, as a kid, playing with Legos. So here's a Lego wolf pack. And look at these characters. So they've got these awesome brown and black clothes. And also red and gray and everything. So I don't know. I think this looks wonderful on them. And same on me, I guess. No, I don't wear socks with sandals or any of the other things you're not supposed to do. So, okay, on the topic of demand and supply, there's some really important definitions here that I think get people into trouble. And I think the reason why people have trouble with some of these definitions is because usually we're coming into an economics class with a lot of really useful economic intuition already from life to this point. Here's one place where it gets you into trouble. So out there in the world, people might say that if the price of something rises, demand will fall. If the price falls, demand will rise. From the standpoint of economics, that's completely wrong. Because from the standpoint of economics, when prices rise, quantity demanded falls. And when prices fall, quantity demanded rises. So the distinction is between demand and quantity demanded. And it's really important to appreciate the precision of that definition, especially because that becomes the foundation for so much that you do in a micro course, and actually kind of for a lot you would do in a macro course as well. So I say, with demand and supply, work really hard to appreciate the precision of these definitions because of this common misunderstanding, which actually I think is responsible for a lot of not so good scores on exams, especially early on. So here are the definitions. By demand, we mean the relationship between prices and quantity demanded. The entire relationship between prices and quantity demanded. This could be represented by a table, or it could be represented by an equation, or it could be represented by a graph, typically in a principles course, a straight line. We're always going to call it a curve. We'll call it the demand curve, even though it's not literally curved. It could be, but for our purposes, we'll always draw a linear curve. Why? Because we just want to focus on the intuition we can generate from changes or movements along or shifts of this curve. And so we actually don't need to make it any fancier than the straight line. By quantity demanded, we mean the amount consumers are willing and able to buy at a given price. So for every price, there's a quantity demanded. For every quantity demanded, there's a price. And for a given pair, we'd have one particular price and the associated quantity demanded. And then for a collection of pairs of price and quantities demanded, that would give us our demand relationship. Okay, so now checking your understanding, a really key distinction is the terminology I was developing before. At a price of $1 million, the demand for oranges, like think the standard citrus fruit that you're going to find in the produce section, at a price of $1 million, the demand for oranges is not zero. But the quantity demanded probably is, right? You're probably not going to buy oranges for $1 million. If you have oranges, you'd be really excited about turning around and selling them to somebody for $1 million. But you're not going to buy them for $1 million. So the quantity demanded would be zero. What's the point of that exercise? You want to think about the important terminology, demand versus quantity demanded. Now for supply, the definition of supply is analogous to the definition of demand. So it's going to be the entire relationship between all prices and quantity supplied. And we can represent supply with an equation, with a table, or with the curve, typically represented by an upward sloping straight line in a principles class. By quantity supplied, we mean the amount sellers are willing and able to bring to the market at a given price. So for a price, there's a quantity supplied. Key distinction, for instance, at a price of $1, the supply of laptops is not zero. But the quantity supplied might be zero, right? If the prevailing market price had fallen to $1, probably not very many sellers are going to be very eager about selling laptops. And the way that we'd represent that concept is say that the quantity supplied is very low, probably near zero. We wouldn't say that supply is low. Supply refers to the entire relationship. Okay, so now here's our model. I'm going to ultimately draw a graph. I'll draw the demand curve, then I'll draw a supply curve, then I'll put them together, find equilibrium, and then I'll tell you what happens at above equilibrium prices and below equilibrium prices. Okay, so the way that we're going to draw demand and supply is on a set of axes with price on the vertical and quantity on the horizontal. And virtually every graph that you see in economics is going to be of this variety. Price on the vertical, quantity on the horizontal. In a macroeconomics class, what's on the vertical vertical axis would be a price level, so typically represented by some price index, like the consumer price index, a producer price index, GDP deflator, something like that. And by quantity, in the macroeconomics world, thinking about the economy as a whole, we think about something like real GDP. Now, in the microeconomics world, we're focusing on a single market, so a single product, single service, or whatever, and so we'll have price and we'll have quantity associated with whatever is that good or service. So here's a demand curve, demand line, we'll call it a demand curve. So we have price on the vertical, quantity on the horizontal, here's demand. And the observation is at higher prices, as price rises, like if I go along the axis, as price is rising, what are we gonna have? A smaller quantity demanded. So as you go up the demand curve, following my cursor, price is rising and quantity demanded is falling. We see quantity demanded falling because as we're moving this way, we're getting closer to zero. On the other hand, if we go down the demand curve, now price is falling and quantity demanded is rising. So at lower prices, there's a larger quantity. This is what we call the law of demand. So the law of demand is as price rises, quantity demanded decreases. As price falls, quantity demanded increases. So now some things we can introspect, we can think about a little bit more carefully about the demand relationship. So now I'm going to draw this with a vertical intercept and a horizontal intercept. The interpretation of the demand curve is helpful to first think about what we mean at these intercepts. So at the vertical intercept, this is the highest price, or really close to the highest price anybody would ever pay for this good in the market, right? Because here's a quantity of zero, here's a price of zero right here at this corner is zero. So if we're going up the vertical axis to the intercept, we reach the highest possible price in this market where people would actually buy something, where there's a quantity, the highest possible price where there's a quantity demanded is right here. Technically, we're right at zero, but people would be indifferent. So at the vertical intercept, this is the most anybody in the market would be willing to pay. At the horizontal intercept, as we move down the demand curve, this is the amount of the good that would be sold, in quotation marks, when the good is free. So if we're giving away the good for free, this would be the amount that we could give away. So this would be the maximal quantity, and this occurs when the price is zero, right? So this quantity, this is the biggest quantity we'll get the market. And notice this is where price is zero. So here's high prices, here's low price, zero price, right? Here's also low quantity, here's high quantity. Just checking your understanding, suppose I'm interested in what's going on at the origin. That's a price of zero and a quantity demanded of zero. It's not even on the demand curve, right? Okay, so think of the height of the demand curve as the willingness to pay of consumers, or to think of it as the marginal benefit to consumers for that unit. So it turns out we can think of the demand curve, the theory of demand, as the theory of marginal benefit. So we're capturing the height. And when I say the height of the demand curve, I mean the vertical height. The vertical height of the demand curve, the distance from the horizontal axis to the demand curve itself at a given point, at a given quantity demanded. That associated price is the most anybody would pay for that, or the marginal consumer will pay for that amount. So as we're going down the demand curve, as we're selling greater and greater units, as we're finding additional consumers, all the people who wanted to buy, all the people who were really eager to buy with a high willingness to pay, bought when we first started selling, for instance, and then moving down the demand curve, people with lower and lower willingness to pay will accept higher and higher quantities until we'll in order to sell a higher and higher quantity, we have to lower the price so that we can catch those with low willingness to pay until we get the point where everybody's in the market. So as the price falls, people start deciding to join the market until we get everybody. So think of the height of the demand curve as the willingness to pay or marginal benefit to consumers. So the vertical intercept is going to be the maximal willingness to pay. Okay, so here's supply. So we think of the supply curve, again on this axis, vertical intercept or vertical axis is price, horizontal axis is quantity. And with supply, at higher prices, there's a higher quantity supplied, right? As price rises, to get onto the supply curve, we have to have a higher quantity. And then at lower prices, we have a lower quantity. So as we're rising, as we're going up the supply curve, price is rising and quantity supplied is rising. As we're going down the supply curve, price is falling and quantity supplied is falling. This is our law of supply. And I put law in quotation marks because unlike the law of demand, which typically holds for a variety of reasons, law of supply, well, sometimes we can get different things going on with supply. It's not, we'll call it the law of supply, but you can get different things with a supply curve. You can get a horizontal supply curve in and some other interesting things, and maybe you encounter some of those things in further study of economics. But we feel a little bit more confident about generalizing across the law of demand. Anyway, so here's supply. This is, so let's interpret the intercept of the supply curve, the vertical intercept of the supply curve, the price along the price axis. This is the lowest price where sellers consider bringing the good to the market. At lower prices, the quantity supplied is zero, right? This is the first price right here where people are considering coming to the market. Actually, at exactly this price, the marginal seller is indifferent between being in the market and not being in the market. We think of the height of the supply curve. The theory of supply is a theory of marginal cost. So we think of this height of the supply curve, vertical height at a given point, right? The height of the supply curve is the cost to sellers. So as price is rising, as like market price would be rising, we have to get the price up to here before sellers are going to want to get into the market. Why? Because if somebody's selling, if the price is down here, the lowest cost firm needs a price here to break even at zero, right? And so the quantity supplied at prices below whatever is this amount is going to be zero quantity supplied. And then we get positive amounts. This is moving over. Maybe this is like, I don't know, 0.1, 0.5 if we allow infinitely divisible units. Maybe we're thinking about like fluids or liquids or something, who knows. And then as we move over here, we're getting larger and larger quantity supplied. And in order for those sellers to join the market, the price has to be rising. That's what our supply curve is telling us. Okay, bringing it together, we have our market equilibrium. The market equilibrium, it corresponds to the crossing point between supply and demand. So it consists of an equilibrium price and an equilibrium quantity. By definition, at the market equilibrium, the quantity supplied equals the quantity demanded. So at the market equilibrium price, that's going to be the price where the amount sellers bring to the market is exactly equal to the amount that buyers will want from the market at that price. At higher prices, there's going to be a mismatch, a disequilibrium. At lower prices, mismatch and disequilibrium. But by definition, the quantity demanded equals the quantity supplied at the equilibrium price. It is wrong to say demand equals supply at the equilibrium price. Quantity demanded equals quantity supplied is what's correct. Yes, the demand curve crosses the supply curve at the equilibrium price. That's also right. What happens if we get a price that's too high? So here's our equilibrium. Here's our equilibrium price. Here's our equilibrium quantity. Let's put in a price that's too high. I'll put P upper bar. It's a price that's too high. It's above the equilibrium price. What's going to happen here? Well, anytime we're investigating what happens at a given price, I recommend moving over from that price to the first curve you reach, identify that curve. Here it's the demand curve. Go straight down and then label quantity demanded at that price. So this right here, this is supposed to be like the at sign in your email address, at. I thought that was gonna be nice shorthand. Maybe it's not. Looks kind of like an I or something, I don't know, whatever. So, all right, so at a given price, you find the associated quantity demanded, then you find the associated quantity supplied. It looks like an E. Anyway, so because the quantity supplied is bigger than the quantity demanded, what that means is at this price, P upper bar, the sellers are bringing a larger amount to the market than buyers are willing to purchase. Why? Because at high prices, sellers are more excited than buyers. So what ultimately has to happen? Well, to get rid of this surplus by definition is where quantity supplied is bigger than quantity demanded. To alleviate that surplus, we need the price to fall. And as price falls, the quantity supplied falls and the quantity demanded rises. And we end up getting the situation. So tracing down the curve, as price falls, quantity supplied falls. As price falls, quantity demanded rises until we reach the equilibrium where all the units that sellers bring to the market are demanded and purchased by buyers. And then ultimately we're in equilibrium. Okay, so we can have a different type of disequilibrium. You could have a price that's too low. So here, suppose you have a price that's below the equilibrium price, right? How do I know? Well, where the lines cross is the equilibrium. So here's the equilibrium price. Here's the equilibrium quantity. At a price that's too low, let's try P lower bar. Well, what happens? We're going to get a shortage. Why? Well, first, I mean, just intuitively, at prices that are below equilibrium, prices that are too low, buyers are more excited about that than sellers. So the quantity demanded by buyers is going to be way larger than the quantity supplied by sellers. We can see that here. For at a given price, again, here's my recommendation. Let's move over until we hit a curve, identify the curve. It's a supply curve. Go straight down and write quantity supplied at P lower bar. This again, this is at, like in your email address. That's what I meant to be. I thought that was clever shorthand. It saved me writing what? One letter. So maybe that's a bad idea. Okay, so then let's identify the other quantity. So here we found our quantity supplied by moving over from this price level, running into the supply curve, going straight down, quantity supplied. Keep going, move over at the same price, right, until I hit the demand curve, straight down, label quantity demanded. Now we've got a problem because the quantity demanded is larger than quantity supplied at that price. And that's going to give us a shortage. Actually, by definition, when the quantity demanded is larger than the quantity supplied, there's a shortage. That's the definition of a shortage. So what has to happen here? The price is too low by relative to equilibrium. So what we need is for the price to rise. To alleviate this shortage, we need to have the price rise. And as that happens, we're going to have the quantity supplied rising. Why? Because higher and higher prices are going to be better and better for suppliers. And what's going to happen? It's going to discourage buyers. So the quantity demanded is going to fall as the price rises until we reach the equilibrium. And at the equilibrium, again, the quantity demanded by buyers is going to be satisfied by the quantity brought to the quantity supplied, the amount brought to the market by the sellers. Okay, so this does conclude my mini lecture on supply and demand. Go ahead, like, comment, subscribe, whatever. Take notes. Wear brown and black together. All right, have fun.